Hi, Chucky, like you read Sing Bell in it, yeah? I really don't mind. You hit me once,
I hit you back. He's bowling like my Auntie Annie when she'd had too much sherry to drink. Played over my head,
then I set fire. मैंने कहा बेटा बेटा होता है और बाप बाप होता है.
Hello and welcome to the first episode of Pie Checkers Cricket Podcast, a freewheeling, unfiltered chat show where four cricket fanatics discuss the happenings in the world of cricket, from Australia to Bermuda, from Sachin Tendulkar to Maurice Adambe, from Sefi Shield to Ram Slam. But just like KP facing to UV's left arm fill, we don't take ourselves too seriously, and our views are those of regular cricket fan. I am your host for today's episode. My name is Vivek. I am from Hyderabad. And when I'm not cursing Shardul Thakur's furious in-swinging Yorkers, I make my living as a marketing professional. And now I will introduce you to my fellow podcasters. Sai, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi. Yeah. Name is Sai. I'm an avid cricket follower. Can't bat, can't bowl, can't field, but can talk a little. Sumer?
Hi, this is Sumer. So I've been trying to emulate Darren Goff's bowling actions for like 20 years now. I still haven't been able to do it well. I'll try. Let's see how it goes. Bhatia?
Yeah, so Shivam Desai, known as Bhatia. And when I'm not loving punting or hitting Dhoni, I gradually have graduated to being a cricket mercenary who just loves close games. That's it.
Fantastic, guys. Fantastic. So what's on store for the first episode of Pie Checkers Cricket Podcast? We are visiting some famous international chokes post-2000. Guys, why chokes? Why is that we are discussing chokes? Why not something else at this point of time?
Kare, you remember chokes is something that links us all from our MBA days? From being in Delhi cricket on the final ball, beat an IPL tournament. I mean, we choked at the very crucial moment.
Yes.
Also, it's a very interesting and a light topic to start. A lot of laughs, a lot of interesting memories. So let's do that.
And a lot of Ben Stokes, right? At that point of time from us.
But let's be clear. Some people choke more than others, even in the NBA days.
Yeah, let's not get over there. Let's not make it known for everyone out there who were at the helm when we were choking. Do you want to start with what are some of your famous memories of chokes, which you think kind of, you know, pre-2000 or whatever you have in your mind, like this is my first memory of chokes.
Yeah, Kare. My earliest memory of a cricketing choke was India versus Pakistan. First series after over 10 years, I guess. First test match in Chennai. Great crowd, great match. Went down to the wire. But ultimately, India, Sachin, and maybe if you want to blame Mongia as well, choked. I think this was a heartbreak.
Didn't they run out game?
No, I don't think so. but you know, I just feel that it was when you're only 12, 13 years old, that's a cruel way to be introduced to choking when things get difficult. But that's my first memory.
Yeah, I mean that was a heartbreak. Yeah, I think with Sachin, everybody else was also crying in India. Shivam, how about you?
Well, honestly, I am more of a post-2000 cricket follower, or rather, I have knowledge of post-2000. I got introduced to the word choke pretty late. So I kind of, in hindsight, feel my first memory of choke is when Australia visited India in that famous test series where Lakshman and Dravid batted through the day. So I think winning 16 tests on the trot, being 1-0 up in the series and then going down 2-1 when they were leading by a decent margin in the first innings and the second test in Kolkata. Post follow-on, I don't think many teams have lost. And I think the trend of follow-on changed since then. So that is my first memory as a series of whole for a choke. I believe winning 16 test matches and then leading 1-0 and going down 2-1 from there is a choke to me. It's my first memory.
So Shivam, you missed out on the golden era for Indian cricket in the 90s, where we won zero tests outside the subcontinent.
Also say he was only sort of following cricket when Australia was doing well. So they started in that 1999 onwards until the end of the next decade. So I think that's basically his push towards cricket.
Memory of cricket or a choke rather, what is it?
Well, my first memory of a choke was in 1999 World Cup. This is semi-final Australia and South Africa. The final over basically, when Alan Donald and Lance Klusen were playing, it was 9 runs required of the final over. The very first heartbreak or choke, if I may call it that, for me to start with. Also, the impact was huge because you expected them to win. They were really doing very well, but ended up on the losing side.
Interesting. I think that was a really tight game. And yeah, great game that was. So for me, I think it was the previous World Cup, the one which happened in India-Pakistan. And it was a 96 semi-final, West Indies versus Australia. It was a close game. It started off really fast with West Indies knocking Australia off for the first 4 wickets for 10 or 18 runs in the first 8 overs. And they scored around 200. And West Indies were doing really well. They needed some 40-odd runs in 10 overs. And they lost 8 wickets. And they lost by 5 runs, 5-3. I mean, that was something incredible. Because I was thinking that it would be West Indies versus Sri Lanka throughout their innings. So for me, that was my first instance of a choke and of the famous Australian fighting spirit, or the never say die attitude. I think that was for me the first example, live example of the Australia's never say die attitude. So that was my bet. So now can we start with the chokes, our top 3 chokes
that I think of when it comes to Indian cricket, at least in the past decade, is the loss to England at home in a test series. For some context, India rarely lose test series at home. And I think that anytime India loses a test series at home, that should be treated as a choke, because you know, we don't win that much abroad, so we ought to at least win at home.
We did win in Australia, you remember? Bigger than 83.
Yeah, man. Bigger than 83. But yeah, you know, if you look at that specific test, the first test in Mumbai against England, how that differs from previous test losses at home for India. I think the 2 series that come to mind are Australia in 2004-05 and South Africa in 2000. Which India lost both those series at home. There, the Pacers had a lot of the credit goes to the Pacers for the visiting attacks, because they put the Indian batting lineup under pressure. With South Africa,
Ganguly, it was a Nikki test match, I believe.
Sorry,
was it South Africa? Did Ganguly miss a test match?
Oh, because no, that was against Australia. He did miss a test match. He was injured.
Okay.
Yeah, but Shivam, you would want to start with your. Your selection?
Yeah, so I think one of the bigger chokes for me was when in Asia Cup in 2008, I think it was in Pakistan, the final India versus Sri Lanka. India were chasing 270 or 273, I think, 274 maybe. And we got off to a flyer, man. Virender Sehwag was on fire. He was, I think, batting on 60 odd from 30 odd balls. I think we lost an early wicket in Gambhir, but then Sehwag and Raina were batting. I think 8-9 overs, we were 70 odd for 1 at that time when Sehwag fell 270 chasing. So basically, we needed another 240 overs with a lineup that had, I think, Dhoni, Rohit, Raina, Rohit, Robin Uthappa, Irfan Pathan, even lower down the order. And then from 70 odd for 1, we collapsed to essentially, I think, 97 for 5 once Mendes got introduced and Viru was absolutely flaying the bowling. I think somebody should have stood up. It was probably third or fourth game that Mendes was playing. I think he didn't play the previous game versus India because Sri Lanka wanted to hide Mendes from India. I at that time watching thought, what an idiotic move. I mean, why do you want to hide a bowler? What dramatic difference does it make? But in the final, I was so shocked. At 9 overs, I thought this will be a cakewalk for India. Virendra Sehwag will score 100. Somebody scored a couple of 50s, and India will win by I think 5-6 wickets. But that was a joke as per me. I don't know what you guys feel about it, but yeah, he was a mystery spinner first time. But you cannot collapse like this, especially a subcontinent team like India, who've seen spinners of all kinds. I mean, you played Murali for ages. So that is my first memory.
Shivam, let me give you Dhoni's quote post match. Okay, most of our batsmen couldn't pick him. Dhoni said, "We had never played him before. We had only seen videos and you can visualize and all, but he was difficult to pick out there in the middle. We never had any real reply against him." Okay?
I don't know, man. So, I mean, you will keep giving 5 or 7 wickets to every debutant. I mean, Vaas was dealt with. They had Kulasekara and Murali. I mean, can you beat that? So, it was only Mendes you had to play. I don't know, man. That was a joke. A big time. Bro, what was it for you? Which one?
Well, to start with, I would say it was India and South Africa in a Champions Trophy semi-final in 2002. This is in Colombo. India had scored 260-odd runs and then South Africa, in reply, was doing very well. Very well, in fact, about 190 for an odd wicket only. It was Herschel Gibbs and Callis playing, the mighty two South African players. But it just started with with an injury to Herschel Gibbs. What's his name? Ashish Nehra bowled a delivery to him, and he just could not, after that, hold the bat. He was also feeling very dehydrated. It's the heat of Colombo.
I mean, that was hot, man. That was hot.
Yeah. He was also feeling very dehydrated. It was very hot at the time. And right after he retired, as you know, commentators would say, they just admitted that they just could not play spinners at all. So it started with Harbhajan Singh. He bowled an over that costed 2 wickets to South Africa. Started with Rhodes. He was trying, Jonty Rhodes, he was trying to sweep him. And Yuvraj Singh at leg slip caught a really great catch, a blinder to start with. And that gave them a lot of...
Short fine leg.
And it was a blinder, and that gave a lot of fans a huge hope, and the team as well. And post that wicket, they also lost Bothy Dipana in the same over. And then Sehwag and him, of course, were also able to get the run rate under check. They needed a runner ball when Herschel Gibbs left the field. But then at a point when they needed 9 and over was when people started questioning why aren't they trying to get into the act together, because it was still Boucher there. There was also Klusner and Callis yet to they were still playing.
Well, expected that from South Africa, right? Like, they're famous for their chokes, right? This is the second choke. You're talking about South Africa yourself.
Do you think that this is perhaps their worst? Because if you look at, leave aside the 1999 World Cup, but in the 2000s, this is probably their worst choke in a competitive ICC tournament.
I think so. And also the fact that it was a, it was a competitive, the impact was much, much higher than, of course, the World Cup as well, but in
2015 World Cup was, I think, semi-final, man, Grant Elliott hitting you for a 6. I never would have thought.
Having
Grant
said
Elliott.
That, you've seen Dale Steyn. He I don't know if he's the same force he's been in limited overs. He's been fishing in IPL for the last 10 years. He's been smacked in IPL, Dale Steyn.
Well, yeah. Interesting you bought the South Africa angle. I was also reading about choking and so on. And I came across an article, a scientifically written article about, it was a statistician in a University of Johannesburg, and he had analyzed a lot of South African games and how they, for example, depending upon the expectation and the run rate they were going through, how many of South African batsmen or innings have ended up in disappointment versus others. And South Africa was there at the top. I mean, there was a graph. I don't remember the journal, but there is a lot of thought around that. People have been tagging them as chokers.
That is an accepted fact, man. I mean,
I think apart, AB
has, along with
EBD South Africa. EBD accepted it after the 2015 World Cup that they that choker tag is on them.
Yeah.
And this has been
Kare, what about you?
Been one generation. It's been like through the generations, this has been consistent. Where there was Hansi, Sam Smith, now ABD. So I mean, I think it's been a consistent across generations. Probably
not yet won a World Cup also, right?
Nothing. Oh, no. They've won a Champions Trophy or Mini World Cup.
Yeah,
that was 1998. The first 1998 Champions Trophy. Knockout.
Was that Kenya?
West Indies. It was in Bangladesh.
Bangladesh. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Kale, how about you?
For me, I think when I'm looking at chokes, I'm looking at things what are online. So for me, what I've realized is it has to have some context. There has to be something at stake. So for me, the first choke was one of the top chokes for me was the 2013 Champions Trophy final, India versus England, where from a 50 overs it was reduced to a 20 overs match, and West Indies or England was sailing through. They needed some 28 runs in 3 overs with Ian Morgan and Bhupara set with a 50 run partnership, and the great Ishan Sharma comes into bowl at that point of time, who was already having a bad match. He had given some 27 odd runs in 3 overs. And we were like, I saw that when Dhoni was considering between Ashwin and Ishan. And I was like, shit, bhai, ye match to gaya, Ishan ko de diya. And second ball, 6. And uske baad, 2 wides. And you're like, bhai, theek hai, chalo, achha tha. We came in this tournament having no hope. We had the match fixing scandal. So in that particular, that between that 30 seconds, I was like, yeah, haan, chalo, theek hai, ab to gaya match. And we had a good run. Shikhar Dhawan is going to be the man of the tournament. Pata nahi. From there, for us to win with 5 runs to spare, I think even though this is before 2015, when England became the England, I feel that was something you should have won.
They should have countered it, man. Ravi Bhopara with his bowling, I think, was terrific in that game, if I remember correctly.
Yes, correct. I think it was probably, it became a little sluggish because of the rain or whatever it was.
I remember Dhoni's reaction like this post the win behind the stumps. Was it like that?
Yes. And I also remember Virat's Gangam dance at the
presentation
and doing push-ups and all. So it was good fun. Yeah, I never thought you'd win, but good yes, memory right. in a good way.
I never thought the game would go ahead, but then
Pardon?
I never thought that the game will go ahead due to the weather. But
yeah,
then
we thought
they got shared. A game. And...
I thought ki, like 2002, it will be shared like at that point of time we shared it with Sri Lanka, maybe. This time also you'll share.
To be fair, in the first innings, India also collapsed a fair bit, Kare.
Yes. But you know what? We keep criticizing Virat Kohli doesn't play in knockout games. And finally, he was a top scorer in this in India's batting innings. He scored some 40 odd runs. So,
peak maybe... his career, huh?
Yeah. Too early.
Like Fakhar Zaman?
Hopefully not.
Yeah. Interesting name, yaar. Uska naam bada acha lagta hai, uska sunke. Fakhar Zaman. Anyway.
So, one question, Kare. So, you talked about how an impact of the game will help you determine if it's a big choke or what. So, was it the fact that England at the time were a really good team, or the situation in which they had put themselves into that match was the one that helped, that sort of determined?
I
score for the game.
Really simple, because it was an ICC ICC tournament final. There is something on the line, and it's a and as the experts say, final has does things to you. You start looking at things differently. A 120 in a 20 over game will look like 150. 250 may look like a 300 in a 50 over game. So final does funny things here. So for me, it was like I think I don't know what went wrong. It was just that plain and simple. Yeah. I mean,
you're right, man. 230 odd India is chasing in a 2019 World Cup final. I mean, they make it look like 290. So yeah, final does definitely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Add to that England never had an experience of winning a very big tournament. Like, I mean,
they had won the World Cup by then, man. I think they had won a T20 World Cup by then.
Yeah.
I mean an ODI. Yeah, of course. Yeah, World Cup, T20 World Cup they had won.
So for me,
what's your next? Yeah, Sai, you want to go about yours?
Yep. I completely agree that big match situations is where people's mettle is tested. So I'm gonna my next choke is the 2016 T20 World Cup final. Ben Stokes final over to Carlos Braithwaite. Okay. Now we all know now that Carlos is a very impressive hitter, etc. But back then he had only played about 7 T20 internationals, and he had played about 7 ODI ODIs as well. Add to that, in that single innings, he scored more runs than he had scored in all 7 matches that he played before in T20 cricket. So to some extent, he was an untested quantity, and the expectation wasn't that he would fail. Let me just paint the picture a little bit clearer for you. When Braithwaite came to the crease, I think David Willey had just picked up 2 wickets. Andre Russell and Darren Sammy both in the same over. They still required around 49 runs in 27 balls. And on the other end was Marlon Samuel, who seems to find himself playing pivotal roles in T20 World Cup finals all the time for some reason. Ben Stokes was given the responsibility of the final over. And Ben Stokes had been their go-to bowler along with Chris Jordan in the death in the previous matches. Case in point, he bowled the death overs in the semi-final against New Zealand. And he took 2 wickets and gave only about 10 odd runs in 2 overs. So at least he had established himself as the death bowler. Going into the last over, there were about 19 runs to be scored. And it was still anybody's game, given the fact that West Indies is a team with a lot of firepower. Do you guys know that there was an argument or a discussion in the dressing room before Braithwaite went in, whether Braithwaite or Ramdin should go in?
Dinesh Ramdin.
With the benefit of hindsight,
Viv Richards would have loved that, right? Yeah. Viv Richards would have loved Ramdin going in.
With the benefit of hindsight, I think we all can say that the right decision was made, but it was Braithwaite who stood up and said that I want to go out there. So he took it upon himself, went out there. He had about 10 runs heading into the final over. And first ball, Ben Stokes, the great English all-rounder, half volley on leg stump, 6. Second ball, not that overpitched, but over long gone for a massive 6. Crick Info commentary says that at this point of time, after the second delivery, Ben Stokes looked shell-shocked. And I quite clearly remember he seemed lost in the middle of Eden Gardens in a World Cup final in the last over. Ben Stokes had no idea where he was, and he was looking to hide. Third ball and fourth ball, boom. 2 sixes, game over, mic drop moment for Carlos Braithwaite. Remember the name. I don't think there's any other situation which justifies being called a joke as much as this. When you fail when it matters most in the last over of a World Cup final.
But honestly, that's a very good one.
Did you ever think England would lose? I mean, when the last over started, I honestly had no hopes, man. Yeah. I mean, 19 is a lot. 19 is a lot. I didn't think they would lose, especially when Sammy and Russell were out. I thought they're in trouble. Samuels isn't. In a lineup of big hitters, Samuels plays a role, but he isn't a
big hitter in the same mold.
Samuels in the previous match versus India also played a crucial knock, did he?
No, it was Lendl Simmons.
Lendl Simmons.
Oh. And Samuels started pretty slowly.
He always starts pretty slowly.
Exactly. He always starts very slowly.
And I love this video pressure he gave after the... I don't know why Shane Warne hates me. I don't have I have a real face. I mean, that was harsh, man.
Sai, coming back to the question you discussed between and you choosing between him and Ramdin. Mm-hmm. Even though international arena little was known of him, but people knew him as a long hitter, as a big hitter, right?
I think since his under 19 days, he may have been, because I think Ian Bishop was pretty high on him. Remember the name, huh? That is what he said.
No, my point is that he was an unproven quantity in limited overs cricket. And on the biggest stage, he stepped up. Now, you can be anybody. You can be Tendulkar, you can be Virat Kohli, but chasing 19 runs in the last over is not easy, even as a big hitter. So, I think on the biggest stage, with 19 runs, which is a good cushion, even by IPL standards or by international standard, that's a pretty good cushion. And the way in which he lost it in four balls, I think Ben Stokes choked.
Don't forget, as we were saying, it was a final. Add to that the pressure of the final.
That's exactly what I will said.
I will go to the extent to say that was probably the best T20 World Cup win till now. Why? Because prior to that, they encountered a rampaging India. And I think they chased, 190, 200 versus India?
Yeah, 180 plus,
And then they came to Eden Gardens, I think, or Mumbai, Wankhede. Was it?
Yeah, I think so.
I think they defeated India in Eden Gardens. And at coming to Wankhede, again, you're chasing a huge total.
Was in Eden Gardens and the semi-final was in Mumbai.
Do you think Brathwaite kind of did not do justice to whatever he started off with as with that inning?
I think...
Well, he's not done with his career. But until right now, not much has... we've not seen much of him.
What about that 100 against New Zealand in the 2019 World Cup, where he almost dragged them from the brink and won it single-handedly? That would have been one of the best ODI knocks ever if he had pulled it off.
Absolutely. Totally. I mean, it was...
on the boundary, right? He was trying to hit six.
Sixes, man. I don't have the numbers, but wow, that I was seeing it live. It was like something special. If they had won, I agree with you, Sai. It would have been one of the best ODI innings. Best ODI innings.
Yeah, this was a good joke to come up with, Sai.
Yeah.
Thank you. I have many good jokes. Bhatia, you want to carry on?
Yeah, I don't know, you guys would like it or not. I don't know how to frame it, but it was more of Sachin choking and so India choking. So this is a game that I remember watching in the college hostel during my MBA with, I think you guys were not there watching with me. I was watching with my other friends, but I remember it was in the MBA days. The match was in Hyderabad.
Some people had also India. Gone to watch this live. It wasn't Hyderabad, you talked about, right?
Yeah,
this was in Hyderabad.
Yeah, okay.
So 350 is what Australia made. And I think that series, that time 350 was not that easy a chase. This is what, 2009. Today, maybe 350, you say, you're still not out of the game, maybe on a flat track. But at that time, decent attack Australia had, not great attack, but decent attack. 350 is huge. And I remember Sachin started off really well. Sehwag started off really well. But then wickets kept falling. Sachin, I mean, fought a lone battle, to be honest. 175 in a chase of 350 is huge. So the position that he got India into was, I think India needed a runner ball in last 3 overs. And I don't know why. Why of all the shots in the book, he wanted to do a misbah? I mean... I think it was Clint Mackay he got out to. Kind of a lap he was trying to do, Sai? He got a final
super lap,
Yeah, so it was typical Misbah shot that he was trying to play. 18 of 18 needed. I think India had, what, 4 wickets in hand? 18 of 18, that is doable even without your IPL. So from there to, from Sachin playing such a short run a ball needed, I couldn't believe my eyes. I thought he'll take it through, man. 175, Sachin is batting. Why would he even play that shot?
All right, Shivam, this is, I think this is an affront on Sachin. That was one of the best ODI knocks you've ever seen. And okay, let me counter by saying this. How could you put this above, as a joke, above Misbah, the Misbah shot, with six runs required of 4 balls against Joginder Sharma?
Pakistan, you can expect anything, bhai. But 175, Sachin Tendulkar, do you expect 18 of 18 he'll be playing this shot? I mean, honestly.
Wait, he had no support. Ravindra Jadeja there couldn't get the ball off the block. I mean, he was Jaddu of old. The Jaddu used to come in the middle order in T20 World Cups and eat up 20 balls. That's who he was.
Right.
I mean, you expect better shots, man. I don't think that was his go-to shot anyways, of a pacer.
Having said that, this is Bhatia's second choke that involves India, wherein India has choked out of 2.
This is more of Sachin than India, I think. That's my way of giving one up on Ponting, because I know Sai will bring up Ponting somewhere. I know.
Well, we'll come back to that.
In due course.
Yeah. Sumer, maybe we can go along with yours.
Well, I will continue the South African path. This is a match between Pakistan and South Africa, 2000 in Sharjah.
Please do not say, Kare, I'm wearing yellowish.
Is that a t-shirt?
Is it yellowish? Green? No, this is not that t-shirt.
Okay. Do you go around wearing this when Australia is playing?
Not at all. Never.
Shivam is what is known as a bandwagon fan. When Australia is high flying, Shivam has been, when they were winning 16 tests on the trot, Shivam was their biggest fan.
Bhai, he hated Mumbai Indians because it had Sachin. But as soon as Ponting was there, he was like, Mumbai Indians should win.
Sumer, please, sorry.
So again, this is 2000. A triangular series. I don't know why they don't play triangular series anymore. We used to have a lot of triangular series.
Because they're one-sided.
Okay. So this was the match in question is Pakistan and South Africa. India was also in the series, but Pakistan had made 168 all out. Really
great
bad.
Great teams to be talking about, Sumer. Great teams to be talking about in this podcast.
Now, Yusuf Yahana, Mohammad Yusuf was the top scorer with 65. It was a really bad batting. 6 single-digit scores. So, obviously, not a good performance. It was thought to be an easy chase. And South Africa, in return, obviously, also started off very well. 74 for 1 in about 15, 16 overs. In a very comfortable position, milking the bowling as the great Ravi Shastri and others would say. At that time, it was Gibbs again and Boucher playing. Boucher was one down. The turnaround was this over that Shoaib Akhtar of the past, the great greatest fast bowling sensation, the YouTuber of today. And he got Boucher out on the first delivery to the keeper of a bouncer. Third ball of the same over, he got Dale Benkenstein out, bowled. And the last delivery, he got Klusner bowled again. So three wickets, a maiden over, and it sort of opened the gates up. And of course, suddenly from 74 for 1, South Africa now is 74 for 4. Wasim Bhai decides to come in and get a wicket as well. So now they are 75 for 5. And in the middle, I mean, but you have to imagine Gibbs is still there and they still have hopes, but he keeps getting out of partners. So Razak and Waqar also chip in with a wicket each. Cut to the final, time when about a couple wickets were required. Waseem Akram was supposedly going to bowl, but Waqar told him that he needs to, and he got the wicket. And finally, they got them out for 101. So there was a bit of a spat there between the two, but since Waqar got the wicket, so it was all in a good spirit finally.
They were 170. They couldn't chase.
They only scored 101 after 74 for one. So only like.
And what time is it, Sumer? What period is this?
This is 2000. This is 2000.
Man, Herschel Gibbs, Pakistan, South Africa, 2000. I mean, I don't know, man, if it is a joke or what.
From 74 for one to 101 all out, this is definitely sort of a very choky game, if I may call it that.
Yeah, choky game. I mean, Rashid Latif and Noman, I think, have again their comments on it.
See this.
So Rafika, just to add some context to the the scorecard, if you look at it, after Mark Boucher was dismissed, Dale Bankenstein 0, Lance Klusener 0, Sean Pollock 0, Peter Stridham 0.
Yes.
So you had like four guys with
runouts. Sai, was there a runout?
There was a runout. Yeah, yes. There was a runout by
Derek Crooks. He broke the lineup of zeros by scoring 5, and then he was run out.
And there were 9 single digit scores. 5 of them ducks.
What are you suggesting, Sumil?
I'm just saying that from...
it was choky. This is not a choke. This is choky.
Well, what I wanted to say was it was definitely in that landscape of chokiness.
But then that was a good Pakistan attack, man.
Of course. Shoaib Akhtar, 4.5 overs, 2 maidens, 9 runs, 3 wickets. Why did he only bowl 4.5 overs?
They never needed him to...
They got bowled out, right?
They bowled out.
But Waqar and Waseem bowled 8 each.
Yeah, because they started off with Waqar and Waseem. For 15 overs, they did not lose much. So there was Waqar and Waseem continuing. Once he got in, he got 3 wickets in his, I guess, second over. And then after that, it was pretty much, regular stuff. They were trying to not get out.
Yeah. I think this joke was pretty well scripted then. There was...
and it's Sharjah, right?
Question mark.
Waseem and Waqar were playing.
Yeah, that reminds me, there is news floating about Daud Ibrahim. Is he dead?
COVID positive?
Yeah, he's dead of corona, people are saying.
Yeah.
Then Javed Miandad would be sad then.
His daughter is married, right?
Yeah. His son. But coming back to the fixed angle, I remember it was a really very it was a bad decision. One bad decision was Mark Boucher. He was very disappointed with it. He thought, I mean, we didn't have really great high-res cameras back then, but it seemed like it did not come off the bat. A. B. The second decision was Abdul Razak. He got one LBW of I can't remember who the batsman was, but it was going down the leg side clearly.
And so I don't see South Africa chasing another 70 runs with those two wickets, honestly.
Yeah.
With Shoaib Akhtar with I think 6 overs to go, what side?
Yeah, five overs to go.
I don't see that happening either way.
Yeah, I mean, not one of the better South African teams. Gary Kirsten was retired hurt, apparently. But if you look at it, Boucher coming in at number 4, that means that you don't really have much of a middle order. Number 4. McKenzie was number 3.
That's too high for Boucher, yaar. I mean, he's at best your 5.
It was a time a lot of wicket keepers were given a free ride at the top to sort of score freely.
Number 4 was top. I don't think Boucher was used this way ever.
Yeah.
I mean, you have Klusener, right?
Yeah.
And who's the captain? Captain Graham Smith.
No. This is 2000. Graham Smith was 2003 World Cup.
Sean Pollock.
No.
Yeah. It was Sean Pollock.
Sean Pollock.
Kare, what would be your next? I think we should move on to Kare's maybe.
Yeah. Oh. So, it's for some reason, it is just... It's not by It's just by chance, not by design. My other choke also, I feel, is ICC Champions Trophy Final 2004, England versus West Indies.
Back with ICC.
ICC Champions Trophy Final. And I think West England were very well placed to win it with 218 on board, runs board final mein. And West Indies 140 odd for 8 down, Courtney Brown and Ian Bradshaw. And yep. Steve Thomason was having the year of his life. And Andrew Flintoff was at top of his game. Darren Koh, Sumer's favorite bowler and or his role model, was at that point. Yeah, the top three bowlers. And 2 wickets. So, and I mean, England should have won. But from there, for West Indies to win, Courtney Brown never had a 50. Ian Bradshaw never scored a 50. And
I don't even know who these guys are, man.
Yeah. So I mean, for them to England, for England to allow West Indies for win from there, with, as you guys said, basically nobody is. To I mean, that was another.
I remember watching this game, Kare. I was at my cousin's place in Faridabad. I was very excited to watch the final, and this was, I think, it will be a damn squib now. Then it was so exciting, man. West Indies won it out of nowhere.
Yeah.
What and was West Indies was doing in that final in the first place? They had an awful team.
I think this was, again, this was a dust ball kind of a wicket. Kare, ball keeping low and medium pace. Yeah. I think a lot of cutters were being bowled, I remember.
Suresh Karthik was the only one who I think scored, basically. He was the one who scored the century. And England scored 100 runs. And Suresh Karthik was the only one who scored runs. He scored 100. Nobody else basically scored. It was all a single-digit score from there. So, and
establishing ICC Champions Trophy, South Africa, England doesn't go well.
Looks like that.
And oh, this is a World Cup.
Yeah. This is all post to pre 2015. So, yeah. That was, Sumer, for you, was the end of Darren Goh. I mean, that was the start of the end of Darren Goh. So, I know. Even though we smashed him in 2002 NatWest final, Kaif was hitting him over cover with all those fours and sixes.
Yeah.
Like, you know. But, I know.
Sumer was actually so big a fan of Darren Goh.
I just wasn't a big fan. It's just that it felt like it felt like an action I can emulate. Like, it felt like an action I can bowl with. And
I also wanted to bowl like Shoaib Akhtar. You know, I emulated him a lot on the basketball court. I think we can move on to yours next. And England's a shit in ICC Championship.
So, I think my next selection is the big kahuna itself. India versus Australia in Calcutta 2001. Yeah. I think we all knew we were coming to this place at some point. Has there been a worse choke in the history of international cricket? Arguable, but unlikely. Who were the principal perpetrators in this? Well, Ricky Ponting had been to blame throughout the series. First test match didn't do much. Second test match didn't do much. To lose a match after following on or enforcing the following on, I think this actually dissuaded the Australian team from enforcing follow-ons going forward for a while. Now, teams might not do it if they want to keep their bowlers fresh, but back then, it was a accepted practice. I don't know what else to say except that the Australians choked on that fifth day.
And I'll tell you what. I'll tell you one thing. Back then, the time that this is, I was a bigger Ganguly fan. So that time I wasn't pointing.
Well, I think good defense.
Ganguly good had a defense. Couple of 40s or 30s or something in this match, right?
Yes. I think he got out late on day 3 to McGrath. And McGrath gave him a kind of a send-off also. And then Dravid came in. I think Lakshman was already set. Dravid.
How can you feed the well-covered Ganguly on the toss with Steve Waugh tactics? Man, that was
mind games at its best if it unsettled Steve Waugh.
Yeah. But to sort of add to your point, Sai, about how I mean, trying to follow, not follow on, and not enforce a follow on. What I'm trying to say, Australians at the time were really very confident that two tests down, 15 more than 15 wins on the trot will just get them out. 16 wins on the trot. We'll probably get them out in the next 50 overs, and we don't really require a lot of freshening up and so on. We'll just
roll them over.
Yeah.
Kare, you were pretty well read. Was it by design that they decided to send Lakshman at 3 and or I don't know why?
So what I remember is I think Dravid was struggling at number 3. And during the first innings, Lakshman had scored a 50 and he was, I think, last out. And Dravid himself came and told Ganguly and Wright, I think I'm struggling. Let Dravid go ahead and be one down. That will probably help you guys better. So I think from that, it totally changed. That decision of sending Lakshman at one down just totally changed the complexion of the series. I mean, in hindsight. Yeah,
Harbhajan, this is the hat trick game as well, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Dubious decision making by our umpires, but how does it
work? And I remember, did Gilly get an inside edge?
No.
Yes.
Yes. Of course he did.
It was not just Gilly. There were other questionable decisions as well.
Sumer, if we go back and look at umpiring decisions and all of that, I mean, I think a lot of test series would have been different in the 70s and 60s with all the home umpires.
Next joke is like pretty recent. It is as recent as I think three or four test series earlier, maybe almost 8 to 9 months back. This is England, Australia Ashes. This is the famous Headingley game. I think Ben Stokes, again, post the World Cup highs. What happened was, this is the third test match of the Ashes, and Australia leading 1-0. They win this game, they retain the Ashes. I mean, that's one checkbox ticked, or rather all checkboxes ticked. Ultimately, they retained it only by drawing the Ashes to all. So they're leading. They've taken a lead of 100 odd runs in the first inning. I think England bowled out for 67. Then they set a target of what, 360 odd. England are in tatters. They need 80 odd runs with 2 wickets remaining. I mean, 80 odd runs, 2 wickets remaining. And to his credit, Ben Stokes, yes, you always expect something post his World Cup high. And he has had that impact earlier. Who does he have for company? I mean, can you beat that? Who does he have for company? It's Jack Leach. I mean, I don't think you could have asked for better from Australia's perspective. He has Jack Leach. Sorry, not 2 wickets left. 1 wicket left, in fact. I correct myself. It was only Jack Leach and Ben Stokes. And they need 80 odd runs. Can you beat that? England won. Jack Leach only scored a single. And that too, I think, when 2 or 3 runs were needed was Jack Leach. When Jack Leach got his first runs. I mean, he was revered as a hero against a bowling lineup like Pat Cummins, Hazelwood, Lyon. There were a few things that went bad. Australia not only choked as a team, their captain choked. Their use of the last DRS where they used it in desperation, waste of a review. Then they missed a run out, a simple run out wherein Lyon couldn't collect when I think two or three were needed again. Missed a run out. Next ball he had Stokes plumb in front, umpire gave it not out. What do? You've already burnt your review. So it's a choke of every order, man. You're choking in your captaincy, you're choking in your bowling plans. You don't know what field to set. You don't know what to do in this situation. I think that was a real, real huge choke.
Yeah, I think this was well chronicled in the Amazon show as well, right? I think Justin Langer gave a dressing down to Tim Payne as well. Because frankly, that captaincy was trash. He didn't seem like someone who had control of what the team was doing. Nathan Lyon was, I don't know what he was doing. But But you rarely see an Australian team lose its composure so easily. It used to happen in the punter era, where when things got difficult, punter would lose his cool. But generally, off late, you don't expect
passion.
It.
That is called passion.
Sure.
Sure.
Yeah. But you can call it what you want. But Australia did choke, and I think it was chronicled well in that documentary. Yes.
That is huge.
On the lighter side, actually, Jack Leach, he spent more time cleaning his specs than he did actually doing any batting or scoring any runs.
Oh, he did his job.
No, I mean,
unlike Nathan Lyon.
I mean, he had some medical condition as well, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, he was not able to see very well. He wore a very
sweating on the glass in the
as they say, he spent more time cleaning his specs than batting it. Actually,
he looked like a techie. Yeah.
Yeah.
He won a lifelong free
Specsaver from Specsaver. Yeah. He won a lifelong supply from Specsaver. And you know how that happened? Ben Stokes tweeted
and
to Specsaver.
He scored all the runs.
Yeah, exactly. He also won him the lifelong supply from Specsaver.
I think Sai won the Sportsman of the Year in England this year.
I mean, he had to, right? Like, he was a force in the World Cup, and
it is not normal. I'm not sure.
He won the top sports British sports person or something like that. But it's, you know,
normal it is not pretty normal for a cricketer to get it. It is not pretty easy.
It's across sports. So you're competing not just against other cricketers, you're cricket against all athletes and sports people. But
especially in England for against football. So yeah.
He was nominated for being a New Zealand Cricketer of the Year also, which he kind of very politely declined as well.
Happily declined.
Who's next? Who wants to go next?
I think
it's Sumer. Should I?
Yeah, please.
Does it have South Africa?
Well, yeah, it doesn't have South Africa.
Give us a good one, man. You're stuck on South Africa.
Okay, let me keep some South African angle. Let's pick up a match that was played in South Africa. This is India and Pakistan 20 World Cup final, the famous Misbah match. What's that?
He said you can talk about Sachin, but not Misbah, man. Come on.
Of course. So India scored 157. Gambhir did very well for his 75. India had played Yusuf Pathan as a debutant, who played a handy 15. To start with. And Pakistan actually started off relatively okay. They lost the great professor Hafiz early on, but Yunus Khan and Imran Nazir had a useful partnership. And Robin Uthappa got Nazir out with a direct run, with a direct hit. And sort of changed things for Pakistan from that point on, the momentum changed. Soon after that, Pakistan lost Afridi and Malik to Irfan Pathan, 77 for 6. So in a very sticky situation. In comes Misbah and takes the game on in his own hands for until he got out. So Misbah is playing brilliantly, you know, hitting sixes off Will from Harbhajan. He actually hit 3 in an over of Harbhajan at one point in time. So did Sohail Tanveer. He hit 2 sixes off Srisant, and then he also got out 2 Srisant in the same over. But Pakistan doing very well until, you know, the last over. Joginder Sharma was given the responsibility of defending the country.
That was the most ridiculous calculation and decision ever.
Yeah. You could say that only until he bowled the first ball with a huge wide on the offside. But after that, it pretty much worked.
Wait, so Shaheem, are you saying you wouldn't have bowled Joginder?
He would have bowled
I wouldn't have rotated my bowlers in such a way that I was forced to bowl Joginder the last over.
Who would you prefer in that bowling lineup that India was feeling that day?
I think Harbhajan Singh, I would have.
Yeah. So, you know what? That Dhoni was asked about the same thing. He, why didn't you bowl Harbhajan? And actually, the reason why he said was he felt Harbhajan was not at top of his game and Misbah had got the measure of Bhajan. He had scored some 2 or 3 chakke marte.
I can't imagine, like, at least all we know about T20 now, I could never imagine a spinner bowling in the depth or in the 20th over of a match anymore.
It just doesn't happen. Especially a T20.
I agree. I'm just saying that I think that's become the norm now. And if he's getting smacked before, he expect he'd probably get smacked in the last.
But to be fair to Bhatia, what he's trying to say is that he would not have ended up with just 2 options. I mean, he would not have ended up with...
I'm asking him who in the bowling lineup he would bowl. He still picked Harbhajan.
Yes.
But anyway, so final over, you require about 15 odd runs. You hit a 6. And then you get out like that. It was really bad. The fact that he chose... What's that?
You're
Ben
inaudible.
Stokes, I would have. Ben Stokes, yeah.
One more important thing, you know, RP Singh, and now we're talking about bowling options. RP Singh bowled a really good penultimate over. Just 4 runs, and that too was, I think, an edge of Mohammad Asif, the last ball. And apart from that, he only bowled a wide.
RP Singh at that time, I think, was very good.
Yeah, he was. He also got Umar Gul out.
He was good. I mean, he had a good run. I would hesitate to say he was very good.
Okay. At the time, he was a good customer to have.
Sorry. Sai, who would you play, RP Singh or Khalil?
Oh, man, yeah. Neither. Neither. This is like, neither of them gets close to a cricket field if I'm chief selector.
You would rather
at the time, RP Singh was pretty good. I mean, India didn't have like Bumrah and the likes of Shami as
that's
they have.
Fine. I mean, I'm okay with you bowling your best bowler in the second last over. I'm okay with that. That's also a strategy. So that's okay. If he was your best performing pacer, you bowl him in the second last over.
I mean, you can't question India won. It's okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to say whatever you say.
So what I heard Misbah saying in one of the interviews was that everybody keeps asking him same question. Joginder Sharma pehle ek aapne chhakka bhi maar diya, ek wide bhi chala gaya, pressure mein hai India, why this lap shot? So bolta hai main kya karun, main agar wo jo main wo aisa shot hai ki main use neend mein bhi khel sakta hu. Is what he said. And he said ki the thing is, it was Srishant was inside the circle. He just had to get thoda sa decent elevation and it would have been 4. What he said that he thoda wo usne aur late khela ball.
Because and he also moved across a lot. Elevation.
But honestly, tell me, when that ball went up, you thought it's gone.
Yeah, of course.
I was camera panned up. Before Shastri said, there is a man coming underneath.
I was remembering Ben Stokes.
Ben Stokes. Then.
Yeah.
Do you think Dhoni shaped the other way had that ball gone over Srishant?
You mean his career?
As a captain. Not career, maybe.
Well, maybe. Of course. And do you know, just before that series, Dhoni had a really bad phase after the World Cup. Point being, he said that before that World Cup, he was feeling really low and he used that as an opportunity to sort of actually lift up. So if that had gone really badly for him, then maybe, yeah.
By the way, Sumer, do you know who was the highest scorer for India in both the World Cup finals that India won?
Gautam Gambhir.
You didn't want me to say.
I think he needs a lot of credit, man. He deserves a lot of credit.
Definitely for the 2011 World Cup. Definitely for the 2011 World Cup.
Definitely in the 2007 T20. If you look at that, he scored all the runs.
Pretty much. Yeah, 75.
Except for Rohit in the end, who came in and hit a few.
He hit like 30. apart from that, it was just him. 50% of the runs.
Yeah.
Oh. And from a Dhoni aspect, yeah, I think Dhoni had nothing to lose. That was his first time captaining a side, young team, the first but time where, playing 20.
Why I asked was, Kare, I think that was when IPL was going to start.
It had started.
No.
It's post T20 World Cup win, then India invested into
T20. I asked you is that Dhoni won it as a captain. I don't think Chennai would have bought him as a marquee player.
Really care. This is like, then who knows? Maybe he wouldn't marry Sakshi. So many things are there, ifs and ands.
So for me, again, yeah, for somebody, it's again by chance. It's the second ICC Champions Trophy champion, and it was India versus New Zealand. It is more of an in a conventional sense, sort. It is not a choke, but for me, it was like India. This was post Debang Gandhi, Vijay Bharadwaj, and MSK era. So, and the famous match fixing scandal happened, and then we started with Sourav Ganguly. We got in a lot of youngsters with Yuvraj and Zahir Khan. That was the first time I saw Zahir Khan or an Indian pacer bowling really fast yorkers in that Australia match. So,
Steve Waugh.
And for us to get into the final with Sourav Ganguly scoring a lot of runs.
Yeah, of course. Yes, Yuvraj Singh debut innings.
On his debut. 83 runs or something.
Debut innings.
Yes. So, with that kind of a background coming into the final against New Zealand, who had never won a ICC trophy. And just prior to that, I remember, I think in 99, Richard Hadley commented that India is an overrated team and they have done nothing. Basically, I haven't achieved anything apart from that 83 World Cup. I don't know why we kind of hype these guys up. So, Azharuddin...
Which is fair, right?
Which is kind of fair.
Yeah, but it's more World Cups than New Zealand has still won.
Exactly.
I'm still waiting, Richard.
Look at New Zealand. What have you guys done?
Talk now, Richard.
So, now with that...
to be fair to me, it was 90s of India. So, okay.
So, no, this is how that was 90s of India. But coming back to this particular championship, so we had scored some 260 odd runs and New Zealand was 135. I thought we had it covered. I mean, like, this was the first time in my when I from the time I started watching cricket and following cricket, I thought, yeah, finally, all my parents keep talking about that 83 World Cup. This is, finally, I have something to, you know, talk
about. Yeah, my kids.
Yes. Chalo, theek hai. So then from 135 down from that, Keynes scoring a century and getting New Zealand over was emotionally heartbreaking at that point of time. So for me, I've still not gotten over that. Yeah. How could you lose? I mean, yeah, Keynes played
Chris Keynes, was it?
Yeah, Chris Keynes. He scored a century. So
when
for
he
me...
wasn't fixing matches.
He was not fixing matches. Yes.
No, man. Do you see how many chokes are there where a lot of dubious characters and teams are involved?
Also,
yeah, but
also you have
played
to,
well in this.
Also, you have to understand New Zealand, apart from in those years, Nathan Astle and Chris Cairns. Okay, Chris Cairns was maybe a little too low, but they had a really dibbly-dobbly batting in the middle of it. They had like...
I will ask you a very, I'll frame this question for you, Khare and Sai and Sumer. On paper, if you look today on that scorecard, which team do you think on paper is better?
Obviously, India.
Now, that's because Yuvraj has played so much. Zahir Khan has...
Yeah, just with Sachin and Ganguly, you're already a far better team, man. Look at their openers. Spearman, Craig Spearman and Nathan Astle. Come on, man.
Yeah, true.
And I love Nathan Astle, man. He's one of my favorites.
Nobody in the middle order as well.
Roger Tooze.
Yeah, Tooze. The big Roger Tooze. Yeah, but to be this series reminded me of one thing. When I saw Zahir Khan bowling those Yorkers to Australians and getting Steve Waugh out when he showed him his wickets, it was probably either him or Darren Waugh. But because Zahir Khan was a left-armer, I had to choose. I had to go with where did Vivek go? I had to go with Darren Goff.
Vivek Khare joined. Oh my God! Somebody's crying. Sai.
So oh, Khare, with the phone now.
Khare, okay. You missed one. I said that my lasting memory of this match, this final, New Zealand India, is Vinod Kambli going for a dive but just falling down. I think that speaks to or that is pretty much emblematic of that entire Indian team in that match. If you look at it, Ganguly scored 100 and Tendulkar also scored 50. And yet, we only ended up with 260 runs. I think we scored a little less based on the position we were in.
260 is a lot, yeah.
260 is a lot, but we were in position to score at least 300.
Okay.
I'm ruling out this Sumer's Pakistan wala match because I think it was pretty inconsequential. I didn't even remember it, though it was an interesting match.
Which one? South Africa, Pakistan?
Yeah.
74 for one and 100 all out.
Yeah. Yeah. That's done, man. Out.
Okay.
Which other?
How about the Champions Trophy 2004 match from Khare?
What about it?
Do you want to rule that out?
West Indies, England one.
Yeah.
Oh, man. That was a joke, man. That was a joke. I don't see it ruled out yet.
Okay. Maybe, I don't know, but considering all the other options, maybe India versus New Zealand, the 2000 Champions Trophy. Maybe that is something.
That is more Chris Gaines. I mean, I don't know. India chose.
Yeah, okay. I go for out. That okay. goes out.
So Pakistan gone, okay. Pakistan, South Africa gone, and England, West Indies Champions Trophy final gone.
No. So New Zealand, India gone.
No.
Yeah.
New Zealand. Sorry. Okay, fine. Yeah.
New Zealand, India. Yeah.
Which else? Okay, let's discuss mine. Do you want to keep these three? I think two out of these three.
India versus Australia? Sorry.
I think I had Asia Cup final, India, Sri Lanka. I had Sachin's 175. Yeah.
That's
India.
Definitely that gone for
go.
Me.
That has to go. 175 from Sachin, that has to go.
That I mean, why go. Why is it a choke, man? You're supposed to win.
It was not a choke. I mean, it was a high-scoring match. India couldn't finish well.
Okay, fair enough.
So, write that off.
Okay.
So, what's left? I think mine, Ashes, is left. I think that is a choke.
Yeah, that is definitely a joke.
Asia Cup final, do you want to keep it as of now?
Can we come back to that? Let's see what else we have and then we can come back to that.
Okay.
Sai, what do you have?
So I had Ben Stokes, the Ben Stokes over, not the Ben Stokes Gali.
I think we'll keep it as of now.
Then I had Australia, India, Kolkata, 2002.
That's a joke, man. That's my first memory to keep.
Yeah, that's a given. And my third was... I don't remember what my third was.
Man, chuck that out.
Whatever. It's gone. Clearly not worth remembering.
Was it India and Australia?
No. I've already... We're counting that, right?
Sai, which one is one that you're not counting of yours?
I don't remember what the third one was.
Okay, so Sai, we're counting two as of now. Mai, we're counting two as of now.
Mm-hmm.
So mine would be, the first one would be 2013 Champions Trophy final. And then I would keep my West Indies 2004, West Indies versus England.
I think these two have to be. Sumer, what about you?
You want to keep? You want to throw out the Pakistan and South Africa? So that leaves two. There is India and Pakistan, and there is South Africa and India, the Champions Trophy one.
Well, both of them are chokes to me.
Yeah, Khare, can you list out eight chokes? Now,
pardon? Yeah.
Can you list out 8 that are left?
Okay, I am actually not having that.
Let me list out. Let me. So for me, let's start with me. India and Pakistan World Cup T20 final. So that's number one. Number two, India and South Africa Champions Trophy semi-final.
Just a moment. India Pak 2020 final.
Okay. 2020 final. T20 final. Okay.
Then,
India South Africa Champions Trophy semi-final.
CT final. Then mine was Asia Cup final. I think we can check this out maybe.
And then Ashley. Yeah. Okay. Then yes. Vivek.
Mine was yours. Mine is the Ben Stokes Breathwaite that stays, and the India Australia Kolkata stays. And my third one was India versus England Mumbai 2012. KP scored, and their spinners outbowled our spinners.
I think this stays, right?
So, for reference, it was a rank turner. And I always think that if Kumble was watching that match, Kumble would have, there would have been a look of disgust on his face. That on that kind of track,
I think where
Pacers took only one wicket and Indian spinners got outbowled by English spinners. So, that,
I think as of now, Khare, which were your two?
Mine were 2013 and 2004 Champions Trophy final.
Final India England. Okay, so which do you want to rule out of these 8? I think Saika 3 look very interesting as of now. Let's keep them as of now personally. What do you think?
Of course, I agree.
Sumer, what do you think? I think my Asia Cup.
I think 2004 Asia Cup. Champions Trophy can go. India and England, right? India and England.
West Indies, England.
Right. So West Indies, England. West Indies, England.
Oh, okay. Let's not keep it then as of now, because we have better games. Khare, I think my Asia Cup can go.
Yeah, your Asia Cup is gone. Dhoni said it was because they only watch video.
So what's left is India Pak final, India South Africa Champions Trophy. I think this can go, right? Or India Pak final can go.
I don't know. It was. I think it. It's a joke.
Let's put it this way: India Pak final, India South Africa Champions Trophy, or 2013 India final against England Champions Trophy. One has to stay.
We should keep India Pakistan then, I think.
Oh. Was it a joke? I think Misbah got them there. Again, like 175.
Like I said, I think if you say that Sachin one was a joke, then this is a joke. More so a joke. But if you feel that's not a huge joke, then even this, I think this was a good match. There just was no wickets left.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take that out.
Yeah.
Maybe this goes, so we're left with Ashes.
In some alternate universe, Misbah has won. Now that is where you have to think how the world would have changed if Misbah had won that.
So we're left with 6 now. India South Africa Champions Trophy, Ashes Headingley, Ben Stokes Breathwaite, India England 2004 series where KP smacked us, and 2013 India England final. I think one has to go. Which?
I think the India-England test series can go. Other...
Man, I don't know, man. That was huge. That is, I think, top 2.
I think
top 3, man.
I would keep it for now. I mean,
top 3. Turner, man. Sumer, Monty Panesar and Grant Swan became Bishan Singh Bedi and Irappalli Prasanna, man, and bowled India out. They took...
So that, which means
they did took good. 19 wickets. Come which on. Means
they did good. Which means
Ashwin Oja and Harbhajan were like Nishi Boye and all of these guys.
Sumer, do you think India South Africa, because Gibbs got cramped? I think choking would not be the right term.
No, okay, let him get out at that point in time. Okay. After that as well, there was Klusner. Nine wickets left. The only wicket that was gone was Gary Kirsten.
I don't know then. Khare, India England final Champions Trophy? I think it has to be.
And please understand, Bhatia. Callis at the time was batting until the 50th over on 97. He just could not do anything.
Okay, let's do this way. In India, South Africa, this was in subcontinent, right?
Sri Lanka. Yeah,
Colombo.
And India, England was in England. So you expect England to win there and India to win here more. I mean, that is how England.
It's West Indies, England.
India, England Champions Trophy final. India, England Champions Trophy final.
Oh, okay.
West Indies, India is done. England.
So. Yeah.
Okay, now I have lost count. So what are you trying to say again?
India, England Champions Trophy final. India, England Champions Trophy final is in England. You expect England to win more than India.
2015, right?
2013. Champions Trophy final. Yeah. 20 over match, reduced game.
Sure.
Final 20 over a match with Alistair Cook opening the batting, you've already lost, in my opinion. So I did not have expectation for the English side. They got themselves in a good position, but I didn't have expectations.
Let's vote, right? We have to.
That's what I asked Khare earlier as well. Was it the expectation that England had?
It was for the match situation. 18 runs, 28. Yeah. 28, 18 balls, 28 runs. Usne bhi fir then you give a 6 and 2 wides and then 2 well-set batsmen. I think
then India, England has to go.
Let's vote. It's fine. Let's vote.
Yeah. I vote for India, South Africa. Show of hands.
To stay. I also then. India, South Africa. Yeah. Man, that was an easier chase. They bossed it up.
Okay.
So, what remains then is this match. The India and Australia and the Jack Leach match, Carlos Brathwaite match, and what's the fifth one?
Ashes Headingley.
Which is Jack Leach.
Yeah, Jack Leach and World T20 final, Carlos Brathwaite was to bring.
I said that already. So, India, South Africa, Jack Leach match, India and Australia.
India, Australia,
and then Carlos Brathwaite.
England 2004.
Okay. Turning track. Okay, cool.
We have one 50 over game, two test series, one test match, one T20. Man, pretty diverse.
Yeah, pretty good.
So, what's our. Are we down to five yet?
Yeah,
we are in the top five.
So those are the top five international jokes since 2000, according to us. If you feel there are any matches which should have been in the top five, do let us know by your comments, or you can tweet to us, the details of which will be there in the description. With that, we are at the end of the first episode of Pie Checkers Cricket Podcast. And we really, really need your support and feedback, so you can show your support by liking, subscribing and sharing our YouTube channel and podcast with your friends. We would really, really appreciate your feedback in terms of what are some of the things which we have done well, some of the things which could have been better, or just what do you want to hear in the upcoming episodes. So that will be great. So I think that's it for now. We will be back soon with a new episode of Pie Checkers Cricket Podcast. Till then, goodbye.
Pie Checker, like you read Singh Bell in it, yeah? I really don't mind. You hit me once,
I hit you back. He's bowling like my Auntie Annie when she'd had too much sherry to drink. Played over my head, then
I set fire. I said, beta, beta, baap, baap, baap.